Hello. Well, hi everyone. Good morning, good afternoon from wherever you're joining us today. My name is Perry, and I'm a senior CFD engineer with Flow Science working in laser welding, additive manufacturing. I know you're all excited to hear Elise speak on laser welding using Flow-3D Weld. So I'll be happy to turn it over to her in just a second. But thanks again for joining us. Just to give you a little bit more background about how we're doing the webinar today, I'll be a panelist and Elise will be the main presenter. She'll be coming online in just right about in a couple of minutes. And when you have questions during the webinar, please feel free to write them out in the Q&A section. For whichever questions I can answer, I'll be monitoring them. I'll reply with some answers to that. And towards the end, we're also thinking of opening it up to Q&A, depending on how much time we have. And then if you have any questions there, if you raise your hand, we will unmute you, and then you could ask your questions as well. So that's something we're planning to do. Elise Jackman will be your primary presenter today. She is a CFD engineer with Flow Science, focusing on multiphysics simulations that include laser welding, additive manufacturing, coating, and microfluidics. So she's been with us since 2018. She has a bachelor's in mechanical engineering as well. So without any further ado, I would like to invite Elise to start with the webinar.
Thank you, Puri. And thank you everyone for joining us today. So what, as Puri alluded to, we're gonna be talking about modeling laser welding with the CFD software, Flow-3D Weld. Just a little bit about our agenda today. We're gonna start off with an introduction to Flow-3D, a bit about our company and the products that we make here. Then we'll go into talking about physics and laser welding processes. And we'll break this down with some case studies and examples. And at the end, we'll go into some additional topics of interest, including microstructure and thermal stress analysis. So a little bit about Flow Science. We started off in the early 1960s and 70s at the Los Alamos National Labs T3 research group. These guys did a lot of the early pioneering work for CFD, including the marker and cell method, the vorticity stream function method, and then eventually led to the development of the volume of fluid method, which is still at the heart of the Flow-3D code today. So in 1980, our founder, Dr. Tony Hurt, separated off and started the company Flow Science. And then in 1985, Flow-3D version 1.0 was released. So we've come a long way since then, as you can see here through our model outputs. And on top of kind of this water civil that's depicted here, we tackle a variety of different applications, including high pressure die casting, directed energy deposition, and many others. So what is Flow-3D? It's a commercial CFD software based on the volume of fluid method. So for those of you who may be not so familiar with this, it's a way to track the free surface of a flow by the concept of what we call a fluid fraction. So in the schematic here, we can see the bottommost cell has a fluid fraction of 1 because it's entirely filled with fluid 1. And then the topmost cell has a fluid fraction of 0 because it's entirely void or filled with fluid 2. And then at the interface, the fluid fraction is given a value between 0 and 1. And it's a way to really track and understand the evolution of the free surface. So as you can probably deduce from this method, we really do specialize in free surface flows. And on top of this capability, we have built a broad range of integrated multiphysics models. So these relate to a variety of different processes, including water and environmental, casting, microfluidics. So we do a lot here at Flow Science. So here are some application examples, just to give you an idea of what we do. The top left, we have fused deposition modeling, which is modeling a heated polymer, which is melted and then extruded and deposited onto a moving substrate. And then next we have laser powder bed fusion, which is an additive manufacturing process where they use metal particles and laser radiation to build parts. And then on the top right, we have investment casting simulation, where we're looking at the evolution of that free surface, tracking temperature gradients, lubrication, things of this nature. And then on the bottom left, we have a low pressure die casting simulation where we're looking at a cold shut defect, which is captured very accurately in the simulation as it is represented there in the experiment. And then we have some microfluidics applications, thermal inkjets driven by nucleation in the middle there. And then on the bottom right, we've got a droplet impacting a fibrous bed. So as you can see, you know, we tackle a lot of different applications and these all kind of warrant different products. So we have the basic Flow-3D multiphysics software, which can pretty much be used for any process. We have a cast-specific software, which is better outlined for specific processes that different metal casters are using. And we have a cloud product, so we can access HPC resources through our web browser. And then we have a hydro product, which is for water and environmental applications. And then more specific to what we're going to talk about today, we have AM and welding simulation products. So the Flow-3D DEM is what we have developed to simulate particle physics, as we can see here. We're taking into account all of the different distribution, mass, material properties, any moisture effects in developing a powder bed for laser powder bed fusion. And then we have the WELD product, which we're going to be talking about primarily today, where we're performing laser and electron beam melting simulations. And then we have our combination product, Flow-3D AM, which combines Flow-3D DEM and Flow-3D WELD to be able to simulate things like laser powder bed fusion, which is depicted here. So that just kind of gives you an idea of what we offer. We're very multifaceted, and we really tackle a lot of these different multiphysics problems. So physics, certain physics are needed for laser welding simulations, right? So we're gonna need to use heat transfer, phase change, solidification, viscosity, and surface tension. So these are all things that we take out of our multiphysics suite and we use them in our laser welding simulations. And then there's some additional models that we use in Flow-3D Weld, which are necessary to capture the molten pooled behavior as a result of laser material interactions. So capabilities include the ability to specify laser beam motion with directional vectors defined for both laser motion as well as irradiation directions. And then we have laser heat flux profiles, which are defined as a user input and allows for specifying the distribution along the optical axis to account for top hat, Gaussian, or other beam profiles. And we also account for shield gas pressure, which is a function of half rho v squared. And this is a pressure value that is applied to the free surface of the molten pool. And phase change, which accounts for heat and mass flux from the melt pool surface, that leads to a recoil pressure that further depresses the melt pool, which is what we model using the evaporation pressure model. And then also laser reflections can be included and are important for accurately predicting the evolution of the keyhole and the effects that multiple laser reflections have on local temperatures. So in this example, we can see how the consideration of multiple laser reflections has a noticeable impact on the penetration of the keyhole. So many of you are coming from different backgrounds related to laser welding. and other laser-based manufacturing processes. And I wanted to give some context to anyone who is not familiar with the industries that use these methods. Generally speaking, laser welding is a joining process, which uses a laser to weld together different alloys. It is used in a variety of manufacturing industries, including automotive, aerospace, and electronics, to name a few. And while laser welding is the overarching theme of the presentation, we will also cover some other laser-based processes, including brazing, cladding, soldering, things of this nature. So the unifying theme here is really melt pool dynamics, which is kind of what we focus on with these CFD simulations. So why do we want to use CFD simulations to model laser welding? These types of simulations will help improve your understanding of laser material interactions for different materials and laser configurations. So this helps to identify sources of defects, such as lack of fusion or porosity, as well as design process windows and welding schedules. And ultimately, these types of analysis can save time and resources by providing a more streamlined way to explore the effects of alloy composition on process design and subsequent outcomes, as well as a way to quickly perform parametric studies without all the manual labor involved with experimental testing. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with FEA models, looking at part scale thermal and stress analysis. And CFD can provide greater insights into the melt pool dynamics at the micro and mesoscale, which are important for identifying defects related to lack of fusion and porosity formation. So output data such as temperature and pressure data can be extracted from these simulations and used as inputs for larger scale FEA models, which don't take into account all of the contributing physics. So what do I mean by accounting for the relevant physics? Here we can see the effect of adding physics models to the simulation. Starting on the top left, 1x power shows you a conduction mode weld. And when we increase the power to 2x, we can see the melt pool getting a bit wider and deeper. Next, we can see the effect of shield gas pressure on the melt pool dynamics. And what's really interesting is when we add in the effects of vaporization and recoil pressure down at the bottom left, which leads to an entirely different molten profile, as we can see with that keyhole formation. And then lastly, accounting for laser reflections further propagates the keyhole formation. And with this comparison, we can see why accounting for these physics can be crucial in getting an accurate picture and understanding of your process. Now, let's look at different laser configurations that are frequently used in laser welding processes. This example was done by Johns Hopkins University and shows the difference between a pulsed and continuous laser on the thermal profile in laser powder bed fusion, which is an additive manufacturing process. As we can see with the pulsed laser, the laser is turned on and off at discrete and repeatable intervals, while the continuous laser is on for the duration of the weld. Using a pulsed laser allows for welding temperature-sensitive materials, such as electronics, where the interest is to limit the heat-affected zones. And the continuous laser is used for more deep penetration welds, which is often necessary when welding dissimilar metals. Spot and seam welds are an example of where you will use a pulse laser to deliver the energy in discrete intervals. And higher energy densities will lead to keyhole formation, which melts and vaporizes the material. And then upon extinction of the laser, molten material flows back into the keyhole and leaves a fused region. And then a seam weld will utilize a sequence of spot welds overlapping in such a way to create a seam. Here we can see the effect that input energy has on both fusion and porosity, with the simulation on the left-hand side showing greater fusion, but also void formation with higher power, and on the right-hand side, less fusion with no porosity. And these types of simulations can be run parametrically to understand conditions which will lead to ideal joint formation. In addition to input energy and material properties, Flow-3D Weld allows you to analyze the effect of laser beam shaping on multiple dynamics. The shape and profile of the laser beam can mean the difference between keyhole and conduction mode welding without change in input energy. As we can see by this diagram, conduction mode welding is a low energy density method, which does not lead to material vaporization, while keyhole mode welding has high energy density and can penetrate deeper into the material. Beam shaping can also have a profound effect on melt pool stability. In both modes of welding, but most notably, multi-core beams have been used to produce stable keyhole welds, which leads to faster production capabilities and less post-processing of the weld. Here we can see the effects that beam shaping have with three different multi-core configurations on the melt pool dynamics. The simulation on the left with the smallest radius produces a larger depression in the melt pool, while the configuration on the right has a more stable melt pool profile. And Flow-3D Weld gives you the freedom to define any arbitrary shape with varying degrees of power and density so that you can fully explore different configurations. Switching gears a little bit, Flow-3D Weld also gives you the ability to simulate dissimilar metal welds, which are common in industries such as electronic and battery manufacturing, automotive, and aerospace applications. Using different materials in production is often useful for saving on material costs, as well as product optimization, where certain materials such as aluminum are bonded with steel or copper to decrease the weight of a part or serve functional purposes such as providing non-conductive areas. There are challenges though to bonding different alloys, and not all have compatible properties. So it's important to not only consider thermophysical properties such as melting points, but also chemical properties such as solubility and chemical bonds. This simulation shows aluminum and copper alloys being welded together, where we can analyze the mixing and composition in the melt pool. And in addition, we can also look at temperature gradients, cooling rates, fusion, and porosity, as well as cross-sectional profiles and melt pool stability, and how this all relates to surface finish. To put all this in a bit of perspective, here's a case study done by some researchers at Shiloh Industries, where they were looking at two joint configurations. The TM1 joint, where the base of the plates are aligned. So let me show you right here. We have alignment at the bottom of the plates. And the TM5 joint, where the plates are joined in a staggered configuration. So we can see here at the bottom, there's a staggering. And here we can see the simulation of Flow-3D Weld, where only the top surface of the joint is being welded. And what's interesting is that we are able to capture the exact profile of the cross section of the weld joint because we accurately account for the temperature dependent surface tension effects, which can be seen here in the comparison of the experiment versus the simulation results, where we're having very good agreement between those profiles. And this is the case of the TM5 joint, where again, we're seeing the Flow-3D simulation. And then we're looking at the profile, not only of the top joint, but also of the bottom. And again, we're getting that really good agreement. So when working with deep penetration welds, you'll often be welding in keyhole mode, as can be seen in this simulation. In addition to modeling phase change and recoil pressure, there are extra physics which often need to be considered to accurately capture the dynamics of the keyhole itself. This includes upwards vapor pressure, which originates at the bottom of the keyhole, as shown in this diagram here. And as the material vaporizes within the keyhole, it rapidly ascends upwards and can have dramatic effects on the dynamics within the keyhole. Flow-3D Weld also considers different heat transfer coefficients, which may be present within the keyhole as the varying temperatures along the keyhole wall can have a large effect on the heat transfer from the molten metal into the surrounding void. And additionally, multiple laser reflections need to be calculated, which is reflected in this schematic where the laser irradiates the inner wall of the keyhole, where depending on the angle, may reflect further into the keyhole rather than being fully absorbed. This results in more heat being trapped within the keyhole and can have major implications for its evolution. So Flow-3D Weld can consider these laser reflections in three different ways: by temperature dependency, through the cosine function, or by the Fresnel equation, which determines an absorption rate as a function of various material and laser properties. And we can see these laser reflections captured here in the simulation on the bottom panel, with the void region being depicted on the top right and the solid fraction captured in the top left. This is a case study looking at the transition into keyholing in a laser powder bed fusion process and its effect on the formation of porosity. This research was conducted at Technical University of Denmark by Mohamed Bayat and his research team. In setting up this experiment, they used bulk material of Ti 6Al4B with a 30 micron layer of powder particles on top. And the melting was done with an in-house LPDF machine developed by KU-11. The setup was transferred into Flow-3D Weld, as you can see on the right, where they performed the melt pool simulation. So the researchers explored many aspects of keyhole dynamics in their study, and for this analysis, they were specifically interested in capturing the transition into keyholing. As you can see on the top image, the melt pool is initially shallow, but you can see there's a hot spot which is forming. As the molten pool heats up, there is an intense recirculations, which are driven by the strong recoil pressure. Eventually, the keyhole forms, once enough heat is transferred into the melt pool, and you can see the increase in those recirculations. This leads to a strong backward flow, producing a large keyhole and allowing for higher temperatures and higher recoil pressures to form. And here we can see the exact mechanism which leads to the formation of porosity within the keyhole. What happens is that there is a rise in recoil pressures and temperatures at the bottom of the keyhole and the top of the keyhole having lower temperatures or forming a cold zone. Eventually, this cold zone closes and an irregular shaped pore is formed. And then the strong downward flow pushes the pore back into the molten pool where they often coalesce and round out due to the hydrostatic pressure. And then the advancing solidification front will then trap the pores in the solidified metal, leaving a trail of porosity. Here we can see the remarkable post-processing skills that these researchers have on visualization of this process. And we can actually see this porosity taking place. So we see that keyhole collapse. Some of the pores are making their way to the surface while others are being trapped in that solidification front, which is ultimately leading to porosity formation in their parts. Additionally, the researchers took their analysis one step further. So typically we're kind of looking at cross-sectional dimensions of weld beads, things of that nature, but these guys actually looked at they quantified the formation of the porosity both as a function of the depth of the pores and the diameter of the pores, and then they compared this with the experimental results. So we can see here there is very good agreement with the experimental data being shown in black and the numerical data being shown in red. And for the most part, these errors are well below 10%, which is actually quite remarkable for this type of analysis. Here's another interesting case study done by the researchers at General Motors looking at remote laser welding with oscillation. This work was presented at the ALAW conference last year. Before they jumped into laser welding with oscillations, they did some work looking at the effect of scan speed on porosity formation in laser keyhole welding. And what they found was that the higher scan speeds led to less porosity formation due to the reduction of recirculations within the melt pool. You can see here on the bottom the comparison between the experiment and the simulation, which confirms the presence of more porosity in the case of lower scan speeds. Now, the reason that lower scan speeds would result in more porosity is because of the effect the momentum has on the location of irradiation in the melt pool. As seen here, in the case of higher scan speeds, the laser predominantly shines on the front wall of the keyhole, which allows for vapor to primarily move opposite the direction of the scan, and high temperatures to concentrate on that front wall. While in the case of low scan speeds, the laser shines on both the front and back walls, which cause vapor to move upward, leading to more turbulence and eventually keyhole collapse. And here we can see that strong vortex flow, which is present at lower speeds and contributing to the collapse of the keyhole, while in the high speed case, there's no vortex flow present. Now, there are some disadvantages to high-speed laser welding, one being that you can have a narrow joint width, which leads to poor tolerances when welding metal sheets with a gap between them. Another is that a large crater can form at the end of the weld due to the larger keyhole that is formed. And of course, high velocities can lead to insufficient penetration, and there are limitations in achievable laser powers. So they went ahead and started looking at laser welding with oscillation as an alternative, and this enables high-speed scanning, which prevents keyhole collapse, ultimately minimizing porosity, and it also offers flexibility in adjusting the joint width at the fang interface to bridge large gap distances. So this video just shows the comparison of the high-speed imaging of the experiment versus the FLOW-3D results. And we can see the path, that oscillating path that the laser beam is taking, and the evolution of the melt pool, which is in very good agreement between that experiment and the FLOW-3D results. So here we can look at some of their experimental results. Look on the left hand side, we have laser welding without beam oscillation. They were looking at two different power configurations. And we do see a lot of cracks, porosity, lack of fusion. So we can kind of picture those defects there. And then on the right hand side, we're seeing the addition of beam oscillation. And what's something to notice is that the powers are for the most part pretty similar. The speed in the case of oscillation is quite high, but the welding time itself remains relatively the same. And we see in the case of oscillation that the defects that are ever so present in the first two are really quite minimal in the last. Here we can see the results from the FLOW-3D weld model compared with the experiment for model validation's sake. The researchers compared both X and Y cross-sectional data, and as can be seen by these images, the weld bead dimensions are in very good agreement. Looking at the keyhole dynamics within one cycle with oscillation welding is actually quite fascinating. So without oscillation, there will be a consistent propagation of the weld bead, whether it be in conduction or keyhole mode. But when adding in oscillations, there can be the shift between welding modes, as we can see here in the FLOW-3D weld simulation. As the laser goes through the oscillations, the melt pool transitions between conduction, shallow keyhole, and deep keyhole modes, which can result in greater stability. Now, there are, of course, some benefits to laser welding with oscillation, as discovered here. So what we see is that it can improve the first time weld quality. enables high-speed welding while avoiding that keyhole-induced porosity. The mechanism is alternating between keyhole and conduction modes within each cycle without the use of power modulation. And it enables adjustment of critical weld nugget dimensions. So we can see here in these oscillation videos at the bottom that we're bridging a gap distance and we're using that oscillation radius to account for that gap distance. And then because of this, it actually improves gap bridging between sheets. So these researchers had a collaboration between General Motors and Shanghai Jiao Tong University, where they were looking at spatter in laser spiral welding of zinc-coated steels. And one of the challenges with laser welding zinc-coated steels is that there is a large difference in the melting and vaporization temperatures between the two materials, with zinc vaporizing at around 900 C and the base steel at around 1350 C. So if there's no venting channel present, the zinc vapor will continue to build and entrain into the molten pool. And this can lead to ejection, which can result in spatter. The zinc vapor also affects the keyhole dynamics and the process stability. And the researchers were using the FLOW-3D weld models to capture the instantaneous, or to estimate rather, the instantaneous zinc vapor pressure and analyze these keyhole dynamics, and ultimately working to redesigning their welding schedule. Here we can see the setup in FLOW-3D weld, which is capturing the relevant parameters present in the experiment, including the spiral laser oscillation path. So in the schematic on the right, we can see all the relevant physics which are contributing to the dynamics of the process. What is interesting and challenging about this problem is the zinc present at the fang interface. So let me just point that out to you, which is right here. Which is, as you remember, vaporizing much earlier than the surrounding steel. This leads to zinc bubbles being trapped within the molten pool. And if the surface tension pressures are not strong enough, then it can be ejected rapidly, resulting in spatter. So FLOW-3D weld can indirectly account for spatter and buildup of zinc vapor pressure to indicate problematic areas within the molten pool. Here we're looking at a photomicrograph model validation, which of course is extremely important when doing these types of studies. So they're comparing both cross-sectional profiles as well as dimensions. And what we see on the top, we're getting a very good agreement both in the dimension and the surface morphology. And then in the bottom image, we're actually quantifying those, the width of those melt pools. And there are minor differences here. So it's something to note that in FLOW-3D weld, while we indirectly account for any sort of spatter occurrences, we don't actually model the material being ejected from the molten pool. So that would explain why we're seeing a little bit more material left over in the simulation as compared to that in the experiment. But nonetheless, these results are very compelling in that they are in very good agreement. Looking at a comparison of the process dynamics between the high-speed imaging of this experiment on the left and the FLOW-3D weld results on the right, we can see the progression of the melt pool instabilities caused by the zinc vapor pressure. Starting with inset A, there is quiescent melt pool present, which is due to the fact that the laser has yet to penetrate through the zinc coating. We can see the onset of this in inset B with the first appearance of unstable flow dynamics in the experimental results that is also captured by FLOW-3D as the laser makes its way past zinc coating. And in the following images, we can see further progression of this instability with formation of spatter caused by that zinc vapor buildup. So the researchers sought to improve the welding schedule by identifying problematic processing conditions through the simulation and ultimately reducing spatter occurrences. We can see the original and proposed line energy functions in the top left, with the images A through D showing the results from the original schedule and C through H showing the new schedule. And while we don't directly account for the ejection of material in the simulations, these areas are indirectly accounted for through analysis of the melt pool dynamics. And again, we see good agreement between the experiment and simulated cross-sectional dimensions. So there's some conclusions to be drawn from this. The high instantaneous zinc pressure at the fan interface led to melt pool fluctuation and spatter formation. The zinc pressure was then calculated at the fan interface and can be an indicator of spatter formation and guide in weld schedule design. And the initial line energy in the original welding schedule was a bit too high, and they were able to reduce this line energy to limit that initial penetration of the laser into that zinc coating region. So now we're going to look a little bit more at laser metal deposition, which is a process which uses either a wire or a powder feed. In this case, we're looking at the case of wire-based laser metal deposition. So this is based on cladding technology. It's also used for directed energy deposition in additive manufacturing. These parts that are made with this process are near net shape, meaning that all of the material from the wire, for the most part, is used in creating the part. And then process stability, you know, can be achieved through optimization of different parameters, including laser power and wire speed and wire feed orientation. So here's a setup of this in Flow-3D Weld. We have that wire feed saw coming in from the left-hand side at an angle, and then the laser source showing its area of irradiation onto that wire feedstock. And here's a sort of a proof of concept simulation just showing that wire feed being melted and deposited onto this moving substrate where we can capture the molten pool dynamics, the WELD profile, and quantify these types of results. So I wanted to share this study in terms of this kind of concept of wire-fed laser metal deposition. So these guys were looking at what they called a buttonhole formation in laser keyhole welding of sheet metal. And they were using a wire feed to join two steel plates. And the motivation here was to produce high quality weld seams in this butt joint configuration for high strength steels. And they made an observation that showed a ketenoid-like cavity, or what they call a buttonhole, formed behind the oscillating laser beam. And it appeared to actually have a positive influence on the melt pool dynamics, which resulted in a higher quality seam of the weld. So we can see here in the experiment versus the, the experimental results, where we have the case with no buttonhole formation. So here, it's a little hard to make out sometimes, but we have this wire feedstock here, we have a laser irradiating down, and then we're joining the sheet metal together at this seam. And we have, in this case, without the buttonhole, we're seeing this inhomogeneous seam, which is producing this kind of like scaling. And then in the case with the buttonhole, which you can see here, we're actually getting a much cleaner weld with this straight seam, no scaling. So they wanted to kind of understand this better, and they decided to use simulations to understand the effect of the buttonhole formation and really confirm what they were seeing within their experiments. So here we can see the CFD model setup, which was used to identify the conditions which would produce that stable buttonhole. So it's a little more clear here in terms of the setup. So we have those two sheet metal here with a gap distance, and this is the oscillating laser beam and the filler wire. And so they're looking at both oscillation frequencies and gap distance as it relates to that buttonhole formation. And what they hypothesize is that the buttonhole is sort of forming this catenoid-like shape, which in nature is proven to be self-sustaining. So it's important to make the distinction between the keyhole and the buttonhole. So a keyhole is directly coupled with the laser beam itself and is highly dependent on the laser beam, while the buttonhole is self-sustaining and independent of the laser beam. And it's sort of this natural shape that's taken to lower the surface area of the opening, which thus lowers the surface energy, forming more stability. And we can see here in the simulation, we're seeing that same exact catenoid profile forming in this buttonhole region. This is the wire feedstock again. This is the weld seam that they're creating. So looking at these experimental results, they of course compared these cross sections for model validation and saw very good agreement between the fused zone. And they made some observations from the simulation as well. So the stable buttonhole did seem to resemble this catenoid, which is self-sustaining. The melt pool dynamics ended up being reduced by the formation of a stable buttonhole. So we can see here in the simulation, this is that stable buttonhole. Here's the weld seam, and here are the two plates. And what was also interesting was the air gap size. And they observed that the stability typically occurred when this gap distance here was along the range of the thickness of the sheet. So that was kind of an interesting observation. And then they also noticed that the stable buttonhole actually occurs at higher oscillation frequencies of the laser. So they got some really good confirmations. They were able to understand this process a bit better by using these simulations to do kind of a parametric study on this whole buttonhole formation. Now, looking at another form of laser metal deposition is that which uses a powder source. And this is suitable to create functionally graded materials with complex geometries. It's a little more freeform than in the case of wire. And these different powders can be pre-mixed to create custom alloys, so there's a little more flexibility there as well. And then it produces high dimensional accuracy of the parts that you use to make. Thank you. So here we're looking at a kind of a proof of concept simulation for the powder-based LMD process. So we're seeing that weld bead form. We're using two powder sources. We can see a lot of that powder flying around. So we can use these types of simulations to understand powder catchment efficiencies and other kind of, you know, laser material interaction analysis. So here's some customer simulations that were provided to us looking at the same thing. We can see the difference between using a laser power of 750 watts versus 1,000, where we have four powder feed injections going on. And we can see in the case of 1,000 watts, we're getting a much more uniform melt pool profile and a better fusion between the tracks. And then we can also look at multi-layer simulations. This is where we're actually adding these tracks on top of one another. This is more commonly used in additive manufacturing rather than maybe laser cladding, but it's important to understand the fusion in all directions of tracks. So this was an interesting study where they were looking at the influence of fluid convection in laser cladding processes. This was done by Yusuf Lee over at Ohio State University for his thesis, for PhD thesis. So they're using in Canal 718 to look at the effects of laser powder substrate interaction, melt pool formation, fluid convection, solidification in this powder-based LMD process. And all of the complexities of the physical model were captured and simulated in FLOW-3D weld. So looking at temperature-dependent absorptance of the laser beam, power losses by reflection, radiation, conduction, and convection, as well as powder catchment efficiencies, which were defined as the ratio between the molten pool area and the powder jet area. And then he was able to derive columnar dendritic solidification due to the influence of the temperature gradient and solidification rate. So here's the results from the parametric study where the laser power was varied between 350, 450, and 550 watts. We can see the experiment versus the simulation there on the right. And what they found was that by increasing the laser power, this resulted in a larger clad width and depth, but not height. And we can see here that the simulation had very good agreement with the experiment. So for, you know, looking at this melt pool front, the cross-sectional dimensions, and there is very good agreement here in the data as well. And this is another study looking at laser cladding, which is done by the researchers at Mitsubishi Heavy Industries. And they had a really interesting problem. They were needing to laser weld single nickel crystal blades for gas turbines that were often getting damaged and were quite expensive to replace. So they were using simulation to kind of understand how they could use laser welding to repair this damage without having to replace the entire turbine. And the challenge here is that the weld metal needs to have the same crystal orientation as the base metal to be successful. So their objective was to maximize the growth of a single crystal in the weld metal. And so how did they do that? They calibrated the numerical models of FLOW-3D weld with their experiments. And then they sought to control the thermal gradient and the solidification rate, which depends on the process parameters and will dictate whether they're forming that single crystal for their material. So here we can look at some of their results. So they did, of course, a process parameter optimization, varying the scan speed, laser power, and powder feed rate. And we can see some of their results depicted here in this image where we're looking at this growth in terms of the experiment versus that of the simulation. And they were able to find some optimum parameters that ended up being 650 watts with a scan speed of 60 millimeters per minute and a powder supply rate of 2 grams per minute, which we can see here in this chart that we're kind of operating here in the sweet spot where we're not seeing too much heat input or lack of heat input. And then lastly for this topic, these researchers were looking, were using simulation and experiments to do a regression analysis for predicting cladding track geometry. And this was done over as a collaboration between Northeastern University and National University of Singapore. So here we can kind of see their pictures of their simulation compared with their setup, compared with their experimental setup. And their objective here was to understand the influence of process parameters on the clad track dimensions. And they were varying the laser power, powder feed rate, and scan speed. And they used an analysis of variance method with the experimental and simulated results to produce a Gaussian process regression or GPR model to further have a prediction tool so they could use this sort of regression to understand future parameters that they implement. So this analysis, they wanted to combine multiphysics modeling and FLOW-3D weld, as well as predictive modeling using the GPR method for this CD process. So they developed and validated a CFD model. They ran simulations for different processing parameters to build this data set. And then they used the analysis of variance method to deduce the three most important parameters which were affecting this cloud bead. And then they used the simulation data to then train the GPR model to predict geometrical characteristics based on different manufacturing parameters. So here are some of their results. They ended up doing 24 experiments with the simulations, and we can see that their errors are really not bad at all. So their track width error, they're less than 10%. Track height was a little more at 12.5, was the very maximum. Most of the time was less. The GPR prediction error compared with the simulations was less than 5%. And we can see here in these images the comparison of the experiment with the simulation. So this is a cut cross section where we're looking at the height and width of the weld bead, which is in great agreement. And then we can see here of a single track how we're getting this sort of like bulk material at the end in the simulation, which is also present in the experiment. So the researchers were able to conclude that this powder scale model can rapidly predict the high fidelity free surface of a single track with different parameters, and this ultimately led to a successful GPR model. So another application of sort of using this wire feed laser irradiation source is laser soldering, which is a non-contact way of soldering temperature-sensitive components. So this is often used in electronic manufacturing where, you know, you have sensitive electronic components very close by, and you're trying to only bond a very small area, which is much more achievable with this laser source. Oftentimes they'll use diode laser, which will be melting that solder wire. And of course the advantages are the minimally heat-affected zones, but also it's a highly precise method for depositing these parts. So here we can see the simulation of Flow-3D. The laser heats the area as you often do when soldering, even in conventional means. And then the solder wire is brought in to the area of the laser, and it then flows into that that area to make the contact with the component. And laser brazing, of course, is another application of using a filler wire with a laser source. And it's used to join two or more close-fitting parts. And the key here is to not melt the base material. So advantages include the high mechanical stability, as well as minimal heat affected zones, and most importantly, having smooth surfaces. So in the case of automotive manufacturing, oftentimes this is used on door hinges, parts with which are highly visible to consumers. So here we can see a proof of concept simulation that we put together. And this is looking at depositing that filler wire in the joint. So we're plotting temperature here, and we can see that through this plot, we are limiting the heating effect on that base metal. However, the filler wire is easily melting into the joint. So that's kind of the idea behind laser brazing, which we're able to capture with these simulations. And the researchers over at Southern Methodist University were actually looking to do just this with Flow-3D Weld. They wanted to determine the influence of brazing parameters on laser beam position on process stability and possible defects. And they used steel panels with an alloy filler rod. And the simulations provided recommendations to them to modify their process parameters and arrangements. So here we can see some of their preliminary results that they shared with us. They actually just recently published their paper, which was referenced a little bit up the way. So I encourage you to go check that out. It's quite a good one. So here we're seeing the same phenomenon. They're depositing the wire and moving that substrate, looking at the surface morphology, the bond that is created. And they were able to compare the simulated results with that of the experiment, where we're seeing this really good agreement in these bonded areas and this cross-sectional dimensions. Now, there's some other analysis that we can derive from these simulations, which are sort of external, but are informed by the results that we get. So in this study, they were looking at determining the primary dendrite arm spacing measurement from the FLOW-3D results. And the overarching goal was to understand the effect of solidification conditions on the microstructure characteristics for an LPDF process. So here's some of their parameters, spot size, powder bed type, and the resolution of the individual particles in this case are very essential for understanding and predicting this microstructure. And then they did a 3D transient heat transfer and fluid film model to study and understand the PDAS. So the focus here was to consider the laser scan patterns, which we actually can't share because they're proprietary to the equipment manufacturer. So they used a theoretical scan pattern in this simulation. And the parameters that they varied were laser power, travel speed, and scan pattern. And they used Inconel 718 as well. So here we can see some of the zigzag pattern from the simulation, taking these sort of 45 degree turns, which is very easy to implement in FLOW-3D Weld. And so what they're looking here is the reheating and remelting of the track. So of course we have track overlap, and we can see that successive path, you know, as we successively overlap on previous paths, we're gonna see significant reheating, and also the cooling rate will be slower as a result of this sort of reheating mechanism. So here we can see some of their results. They were able to extract thermal gradient and solidification rate data from the FLOW-3D model. And then this was then transferred into a cooling rate data by doing G times R. And then they used this data in PDAS models, including Trivedi and Kurz-Fischer, to determine this microstructure results. So the simulations predicted a PDAS to be between 1.32 microns and 1.84 microns, and the experimental data showed ranges from 0.9 to 1.8. So we're seeing great agreement there as well, and this is, you know, to determine where locations of coaxial and equiaxial fusion and microstructure areas. So we can also do thermal stress analysis or we can extract data to do thermal stress analysis with FLOW-3D. So what we do is we extract the pressure and temperature data from the results. So we can see here a fused particle bed, and all of the internal structure is defined with this data. And then we can import this data into FVA packages such as the ones listed here. And then we can do these types of analyses where we're looking at displacements, bond mesis stresses, to understand, you know, this sort of FVA side of the simulation. And then before we kind of open this up for discussion, I want to talk about a couple of events and workshops that we have coming up. We at Flow Science are sponsoring the MCW ASP conference coming up on the 22nd, 23rd of June. This is online, and we are having actually coinciding 40th anniversaries this year. So if you'd like to go to this conference, it's really great for anyone interested in modeling casting, welding, or additive manufacturing processes. And if you use the code FLOW3D, FLOW-3D-40, you can save 30% on your registration. So I highly encourage you to join this conference. And additionally, we have a workshop coming up on June 25th and 26th. So this is going to be covering a lot of modeling with laser welding and additive manufacturing. And it's a two-day workshop for half days, 12 to 3 p.m. Eastern. And you'll get hands-on experience with the software. We go through theory, we go through model setup, and then at the end of it, you get a free 30-day license so that you can use the software to model, you know, your own problems on your own. So details can be accessed there at the bottom link. I'm going to send you guys this presentation, recording, and slides afterwards, so you can access this link there, or you can just go to flow3d.com, and you can go to our workshop section. So in summary, from all of what we've covered, I just want to reiterate that high-fidelity CFD simulations using Flow-3D Weld provide valuable insights to these laser welding processes. So we're able to analyze melt pool dynamics at the micro and meso scales. We can make useful predictions for fusion and porosity as a function of process parameters. We can design process windows and welding schedules. And then in addition to a lot of the case studies that I presented today, we have I think over 90 publications in our bibliography, which you can access at this link as well. Or if you, again, just go to our website and go to bibliography, under additive manufacturing and welding, we have a ton of case studies from academia and industry researchers. You can contact me at my email here, elise.jackman@flow3d.com. And Paris' email is not included here, but he's at paris.alu@flow3d.com. And then we're going to send you out the slide and the recording, and then we'll go through this Q&A and pick out some of your questions and try to kind of get back to you in short order so that we can make sure that all of your questions have been answered. And, you know, if there's something that you want to know more about and you'd like to schedule a call with us, or you want, you know, to get a little more information, I'm happy to, you know, do things more individually and look at individual processes and how we would model them in Flow-3D. So please feel free to reach out and continue this conversation.
Sounds good. Thanks so much, Elise. And thank you, everyone, for joining us once again. So we look forward to hearing from you and continue the conversation. Take care, and we'll be in touch.
Thank you so much, everyone.